I am currently sipping coffee.
It's gotta be four.
Which, if you weren't here, like, if you got here early, there was no coffee. There's coffee now, so if you need coffee, I won't take offense if you get up and go get coffee. Now, you might ask the question, why was there no coffee? Why was there no coffee at 10:30 when church starts? Why did it not get here till like 11, 11:15? I have a really good answer for that. So we have, making coffee is one of the roles, like one of the volunteer roles. And there's only a few people that, you know, have signed up and have been sort of trained on how to do it. And none of those people were available today. So I thought, well, I'll just do it. I'm here early anyways. I'll get the coffee going. I've never done it before, but I can do this. Sarah Nichter, who kind of oversees that, sent me the instruction sheet. And I followed the instruction sheet. Now, I'm a 3 on the Enneagram, okay? So for me, making coffee isn't about making coffee. I need to make sure it's the best coffee. I need to make sure that when you have a drink, you're like, damn, that tastes really good today. And you even think, I wonder who made this. So that at some point, I can let it slip that I made the coffee, and you'd be like, whoa, that guy makes really good coffee. This is the neuroses that happens inside of a 3. So mm-hmm. I do all the steps, and I plug in the thing, and I pour in the water, and I put in the coffee, and there's on-off button. Not super challenging. I push the on button. No light comes on. I'm like, that's kind of weird. I text Sarah. She says, no, the light doesn't come on until after it's done percolating. It takes about 45 minutes. I'm like, oh, okay, I'm good. I walk away. An hour later, I come back. I'm like, this thing feels cold. I open the lid, dry as a bone, like nothing has been happening for the last 45 minutes. And I'm like, not only did I not make the best coffee, I didn't make any coffee. This is fantastic. Turns out the thing that I plugged into like tripped the breaker, and so it just never actually turned on. So moved it over to an outlet that works, and that's why you didn't have coffee until about 5 minutes ago. It takes 45 minutes to cycle all the way through, and when you don't start that till late in the process, it's just too late. So anyway, long story short, there's coffee if you need it. Sorry it wasn't available beforehand. That probably is the last time they'll have me make the coffee, even if it's the best cup you've had all week. Okay. So speaking of Enneagram, that's what we're doing for Lent. Season of Lent is we are going on an inward journey. We sang that the second song we sang was an all sons and daughters song, and the lyrics are, I could just stay right where I am and never leave the comfort of that. But when we begin a journey with God, God calls us deeper, God calls us higher, God invites us to go into the scary parts. And so that's what we want to do during the season of Lent, is go into some of the scary parts. We could stay where it's safe, or we could say there is more life, more flourishing, more abundance to be had, and I want that, so I got to go through some of the scary parts. That's what we're doing with the Enneagram. Last Sunday, Kate and I shared with you why we find the Enneagram so compelling, because it's a tool that allows you to see sort of your internal motivations, why you do what you do. It brings up some of your shadow stuff so that you can deal with it, but then it provides a path forward for transformation. Okay, so here's why you do what you do. Here's where some of your neuroses come from. Now here are some ways that you can move forward into health and wholeness. So I'm going to say a word of prayer, and then we're going to jump into starting with the number 8 this morning. Let me say a word of prayer, and then we'll dive in. Everybody take a deep breath in, would you? And exhale. It's been suggested that the human body operates ideally with about 6 breaths a minute. But the average person functions more like 15 to 20. Which is just this symbol of our frenetic pace and our struggle to slow down sometimes or all the time. So take another deep breath in and exhale. God, this morning we as a community, as people who have shown up on this morning for whatever reason, some of us for the first time, some for the 100th time. We're here because I think on some level we hear this call beyond us to go higher, to go deeper, We hear, we sense that there's more to life, and we want it. And so we're here because maybe on some level we think there's something here that can help. There's something in a church, a faith community, a group of people where I know I can be seen and loved. And so we're here, God. We have shown up. And now my prayer is that over the next few moments together, Spirit, that you would speak the word that we need to hear this morning in whatever way we need it. If there's anything that I or Kate says this morning that is good, that is true, that would be helpful for someone on their journey of faith, my prayer is that it would stick in our minds, that it would resonate with us all week long. And then conversely, if there's anything we say that is untrue or would be unhelpful for someone, would your grace let us forget it? So may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing. And the loved sons, daughters, and children of God said, amen. Amen. That's you, by the way, the loved sons, daughters, and children of God. That's good coffee. Okay. All humans, on some level, all humans have a need to be in control. Or at least, if not to be in control, have a need to not be controlled. This is a thing that is a common experience for what it means to be human. We want to be free. Inherently, we want to not have someone else or something else exercise dominion, control over us. And when others start to control us, or at least we perceive they start to control us, we react to that. We react to that. Now for 8's, which is what I'm going to talk about for the next few minutes, for 8's, this need to be in control, or at least to not be controlled, it shines brighter than the other needs that we talked about last week. This is sort of the need that's behind all the things. They don't want to be controlled. They do not want to be harmed or hurt. 8's are often called the challenger. The challenger. And this is because, in part, 8's tend to start with the belief that the world is threatening. The people are out to get me. There's a hostile world out there. That's sort of the fundamental, like I see some of you 8's nodding like, yeah, the world is a hot, why are you saying that as though that might not be true? Like 8's are like this, the world is hostile. People are out to get me in some way, shape, or form. And an 8 typically won't trust that that's true until proven, or that truth that's not true until proven otherwise. Now, oftentimes, let me step back up for a minute. So the way this series is going to work is Kate and I are going to each week take two numbers, share a bit of them with you, and then bring up somebody from the community who is that number and let you hear from them personally. And though the temptation may be, oh, that's not my number, I'm just going to sort of check out and wait till my number, which I resonate with that, that's totally my default. My encouragement is, however, even though this may not be your number, there are many numbers that show up in our life anyway, but more importantly, you have these in your life. You have 8's in your life. And so one of the main goals, like we talked about last week, is you can now begin to understand the people in your world better. Okay, so that's how the next few weeks are going to work. We're going to talk about it, we're going to interview, and it's going to be fantastic. So 8's are typically big personalities, big personas. 8's are often intense, they're passionate. They'll have like even a big physical stature, and even if they don't, they will project one. Okay, so 8's just have this sort of big, intense persona about them. When 8's are at their best, most healthiest, most flourishing, they are heroic. They fight for the little person. They fight for the weak, the outcast. They're decisive and strong leaders. These are healthy 8's. When they're operating from places of unhealth, when 8's maybe aren't conscious of some of the things that are going on inside of them, when they haven't done a lot of self-awareness or self-work, or they're not tending to their soul, 8's are often paranoid, thinking people are out to get them. They can be isolated. They can plot their revenge on others, just sort of spend their own time thinking how they're going to get back at the people who got them. 8's can tend to be rather dictatorial. thinking things like my way or the highway, or things like might makes right. Unhealthy 8's will steamroll people, not looking back and very rarely apologizing. My way, highway, if you don't like it, tough, I ain't slowing down for you. Now, I got to share this with you. I was immersing myself in the world of 8's, especially this week, and when I was really spending time with like what happens when an 8 gets unhealthy and when they start to live from a place of an undernourished soul, if you will, that was super triggering for me. Like really triggering for me. And the reason why is because I spent almost 2 years of my life under the authority, under the control of an 8 and a very unhealthy 8. And as I'm reading about this, it was just bringing up all these feelings again of what that was like. And it's like I was experiencing it all over again. I almost text Kate and said, never mind, we're switching. I'm doing 9's. I can't do 8's. Like, I just can't go there. Bringing up all these feelings again of control and manipulation and paranoia. But then I stopped and I remembered. I kid you not, this was the process of like my flow this week. I freaked out, almost bailed on it, and then I had this moment of, wait a minute. Part of this whole Enneagram thing is to understand why people act the way they do. To understand how messages that they received early on or didn't receive early on informed that. And when we can better understand people and why they do what they do, that leads to compassion. And then when we have compassion, that leads to love. So I had to go back and reread all the stuff I had already read about how 8's become the way they are with this individual in mind and be like, okay, I need to see the child in that person. I need to apply some compassion, grace, understanding. And I had to do this whole process this week. So if that comes up for you in any of these, with any of these numbers, again, the goal is that you would begin to understand people better and take it less personal. Okay, this isn't necessarily me. This is sort of them acting out of their own unhealth or the messages that they got as a child, whatever it is. And if you let the sort of the inside of the Enneagram, if you let it, they can help move you from a place of resentment and bitterness to a place of compassion and kindness. And I really think that's true and has been true for me. So then for 8's, what is that wound? What is that fear? What is that thing that the 8's grew up with that helped shape their personality? Like I said earlier, 8's, their deepest fear is to be controlled by someone else. They don't want to be hurt. They don't want to be controlled by someone else. And so oftentimes what that is it's a result of the fact that at some point in their life, they were betrayed by someone that they loved. They were harmed by someone that they loved. For an 8, there was someone that they were close to, that they trusted, that ultimately betrayed them or harmed them in some way. And so as 8s grow up, they develop strategies on how to protect myself from that ever happening again. I do not want to be betrayed again. I do not want to be harmed again by others. And even if it wasn't a blatant betrayal, maybe you can't point to like the singular moment of it, there was still this message of, you've got to be tough because the world is going to get you. The world is dangerous and hostile. And so 8's developed this sense of, as long as I'm in control, I won't be hurt or betrayed. Like that is sort of the fundamental, like, I can't experience that wounding again. I won't allow myself to be hurt or harmed again. So I have to be in control. And as long as I'm in control, or don't have others have control over me, I am shielded from betrayal, I'm shielded from harm. Does that make sense, how that works? And again, all of humans, we all do this. We all have our own ways of protecting ourselves from being hurt. But for 8's, this is the strongest fear, the deepest need about them. So for the 8, they believe all's going to be okay, all's going to be good as long as I'm strong and in control. Then I'm okay. And things will begin to not be okay the minute I am not in control or that someone else has control over me. That's when the panic sets in. Not being in control is the scariest thing for an 8. So what happens is they can struggle sometimes to open themselves up to others in a deep and meaningful way. They will struggle to do that thing which causes deep connection, which is opening themselves up and saying, here I am. Because when you open yourself up and expose yourself to someone in a deep and meaningful and authentic way, what happens? You leave yourself vulnerable. Now they have the ability to have some sort of power over you. And so an eight will keep a hard shell on the outside. I ain't going to let people get too close to me. And then a beautiful thing about eights is if they take that risk and if they let that armor down and they let someone in and see the soft inside and that person responds with trust and love, then an eight, that gift to them is a treasure. Like if you have an eight as a close friend, they are fierce. Like they will take a bullet for you. They will honor the fact that you saw their weakness and still loved them, and they will become like your biggest, strongest ally. When you have a close eight friend, there's like almost nothing better than that. That attachment becomes intense. A couple strengths of the eight. All the numbers in the Enneagram have a unique way in which they respond to their particular fear or need. And what it does is it manifests unique strengths across the Enneagram. So eights, they're amazing strengths. Many eights are strong and independent people. Right? So the neurosis is I have to be strong and take care of myself. But that leads to being a strong and independent person, which is a pretty valuable asset to have. Eights can bring an intensity to any space. They have no problem speaking their mind. And they can get frustrated when others don't. So if you're in a relationship with an eight, they will have no, like, speaking their mind, that's just what you do. And they can smell BS from a mile away. Like, that is not really how you feel. And they have very little respect or tolerance for people who don't just say what they think or feel. They value and they want the other person to, like, just rise up and own it. Even if we disagree, even if they have conflict, because for eights, conflict is connection. It's true. Most of the rest of you are like me, and you're like, why the heck would I want to engage in conflict? For eights, that's like a connection for them. They actually thrive in that environment. Because of their intense desire and drive to not let other people have control over them, when they see that happening to others, something for eights just flicks on and they become incredible champions for the weak, the marginalized. Like if they see other people being abused or under the control of others, that just fires them up. And so a huge strength of the eight is they are amazing advocates, allies, fighters, champions of justice. If they see injustice happening, that gets to them like almost no other number on the Enneagram. Now, so maybe you're not an eight this morning, but you are thinking that there might be some eights in your life. Side note, asterisk, come down here for a minute. I encourage you to not try and assess the people in your life and what number they are. Or at least if you are, don't tell them. Okay? Because nobody can truly, deeply know their number other than themselves. Because all you see, even with the person closest to you, you still see just a lot of the external manifestation. That's not always that doesn't always tell you. It's the internal things. And so you might have a real good sense of who is what number, and maybe you're right, but just have caution stepping into that space until either they reveal it to you or they reveal it to you. I don't know why I said tell either, whatever. But if you have eights in your life, a couple things I want you to keep in mind. Eights really struggle to see nuance. Eights are black and white people. Shades of gray don't really register for them. And part of that is because, like, shades of gray require nuance. They require, like, maybe not fully owning your thing. And so that's a sign of weakness. And for an eight, like, weakness isn't a thing I have any respect for. Like, weakness means you're exposed, which means you can be controlled by others. And weakness must be avoided at all costs. So they have a demand for clarity, and they can be very black and white thinkers. So just know that. They have a tendency to categorize the people in their life as friend or foe. You're either with me or you're against me. At which point, 8's are like, doesn't everybody do that? I don't get it. Like, which is one of the beautiful things about the Enneagram. You realize how the way you see the world, you just assume everybody else sees it like that, and you're like, oh, man, you're telling me that you could make a pot of coffee and not be thinking, this better be the best cup of coffee anybody's ever had? That's how I approach everything I do in life, and I have assumed up until the Enneagram that everybody else always wants to win and achieve and succeed. And it's weird to me when people, like, don't think that way. Like, oh my gosh, people think differently than me. So 8's are like, you're either with me or against me. I will either take a bullet for you, or I will either put a metaphorical bullet in you. Like, this is how 8's live. They get connection out of conflict. So you might find conflict scary, but 8's say, I'm bringing all of me. I want you to bring all of you. I read this week that 8's can start a fight in an empty house. It's just how they roll. But here's the thing. If you have 8's in your life, I think the bottom line that I want you to hear is that 8's need to hear from you. More often than probably any other number, they need to hear from you that you're not going to betray them. They need to have that reinforced. Like, I'm not going to betray you. I'm not going to betray you. It doesn't mean I might not let you down, but I'm not going to betray you. Like, you can trust me. I'm here in your life, and I love you. Show them that you want to see beyond their tough exterior. And then when they show you their softer side, love them for that. Now, if you're an 8 and you're here, there's some good. The good news that I want to share with you about 8 is, and by the way, I have a lot of 8-ness in my life. Ultimately, that's not my number, but I can resonate a lot. I have a lot in common with an 8. What I hope you see is that you have this initial posture towards the world that the world is a hostile place. And what I would hope would be the good news for you is to hear me say that the world is not a hostile place. There are hostile elements in the world. There are people, maybe. But the hope would be to move from a posture of assuming everybody's out to get me to just let that down a little bit and say, maybe not everybody is out to get me. But if you try telling an average 8 that, they'll think you've gone mad. Like, it's really, like, you can't, if I'm an 8, you're having a hard time convincing me that you know, people aren't generally, like, trying to get me. So the work of the 8 is to rebuild some of those narratives that the world is not a hostile place. The invitation for the 8 as a path to transformation is to get back in touch with that innocent child in you. To get in touch with that innocent child in you before he or she started mistrusting the world. Reconnect with that child in you that was hurt or betrayed in some way. Reconnect with that child that was told, you've got to be tough if you want to survive. And then the goal would be to say to that child in you, I see you, and I know that you were wounded. But together, let's trust that not everyone in life will treat us like this. Let's drop our guard together. I've got you. Let's let people in. And you know what? If we let people in, if we open up and they do hurt us, let's not close ourselves back off again, but let's just stay open, believing and trusting that we will be okay, that we will be okay. Say to that child inside of you, I'm sorry that no one told you growing up that you won't be betrayed by those closest to you. I'm sorry you didn't get that message, but I've got you now. I've got you now, and I won't betray you. So to the beautiful 8s among us, may you slowly and graciously drop your armor. Relax that tough exterior shell. May you practice trusting others to see you and your weaknesses, to see that you actually can't do it all by yourself. The beginning of transformation for many 8s is to ask for help in those in their life. May you begin to see that acknowledging struggle is not a sign of weakness, but actually that's the beginning of true strength. May you be ever aware of your tendency to try and force or control your life and practice letting go. And sweet 8s, may you be liberated from this me against the world posture that you so often can default to. And for good reason, we see you and we understand you. And of course you would respond that way. But may you be liberated from this me against the world posture and lean into your passion for justice. Lean into your natural ability to help those who are in need. Because the truth is, 8's, we need you. We need you. The other 8 numbers need you. We need you to lead us in the pursuit of justice. We need you to help us get clear about what really matters. We need you to take risks and fight for what is right. And I'll end with the words of Diane Tolomeo, a teacher of the Enneagram, who says this: people who can only imagine a gentle and unchallenging God might want to dismiss the confrontational power of 8's as somehow lesser channels of the divine. The 8's, however, listen to me now. The 8's, however, bring to our attention the strong, powerful, and just side of the divine presence in our world. And in so doing, they become clear manifestations of holy truth. Amen?
Amen.
Benjamin, brother, come on up. I'm going to just take like 3 minutes, because I've eaten into Kate's time a little bit.
Uh-huh, hurry up.
Everybody say hi, Benjamin.
Hi.
So Benjamin is a self-identified 8 on the Enneagram. And can you just share with us, Benjamin, what the process was like for you to discover that?
Yeah.
What were some of the feels around that?
Well, so my journey into the Enneagram started about a year ago, probably with a lot of people, with the liturgists talking about it and a few other channels around that.
I'm not going to control you, just a little bit closer.
Is that good?
That's great. Yeah.
Are we happy?
So what was it like when you discovered that you were an 8?
I didn't want to be an 8.
Yeah.
So the process led me along. I really wanted to be a 7 because I wanted to be fun. But I listened to the Road Back to You podcast, and Nadia Bowles Weber was on there talking about her 8-ness. And it was like my big sister was talking to me. And I was just like in tears, like, oh, it's not all bad to be this 8 thing. It sounded like a real jerk, but I was just kept seeing all the things I didn't want to see in me in that. So it was hard,
yeah,
but good to finally feel like seen and known. And then when I started finally like processing through that, like it's been real helpful to see that everybody doesn't, like you said, everybody doesn't see the world the way I see it. Mm-hmm. I have a real hard time with empathy.
Yep.
Like, that's not my strong suit. Seeing people, it's like, just get over it. Just get past it. You know? Hurricane Katrina, okay. Yeah, it sounds real crappy. But that's how I felt. I wanted to just be like, well, okay, now we keep moving. It was a natural disaster. We have no control over that situation. So there's nothing we can do. Let's feed these people and move on. Let's get them housing. Let's do something, but let's not, you know, stay there.
Yeah.
So that seems crazy. That's how I feel.
Yeah. It's not crazy, brother. It's not crazy. So what's one of the things that you love about being an 8? How has it really served you in your life?
I like that. So I'm beginning to see how it is good. How it is good where I've... Oh, it's way easier for me to talk about how I hate it. But for I love it because I like to fight. I like to know that, like, hey, not everyone will fight, but I'll get out there and put my body in the way.
Yeah.
You know, like, it feels good to, like, now that I'm on this side of it, like, help people.
Yeah.
You know, it didn't feel good necessarily to constantly be in fear of everybody. And I still have a hard time. I was talking to Anissa yesterday about, like, I always have an escape plan. Hmm. Like, for the family, like, we're at Disneyland, and I'm thinking, all right, if a shooter comes in, there's, like, a staff entrance, and there's a staff entrance. Surely the shooter won't come in there, if I'm thinking the way he would. Like, if someone has the guts to do that.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah.
So
take 8's to Disneyland, I guess, is the takeaway.
A lot of fun.
And then what's the way... Thank you for sharing. I know how vulnerable this can be to speak into this space, so thank you. And then just close with, like, I don't know, what's one way that you've seen your eightness kind of get in the way, get in your own way? Like what sort of blocked you to becoming the person that you want to be?
Well, it is the protection. It is the armor. It's the not feeling, just dismissing the need to be vulnerable. Mm. Becoming vulnerable is—it's amazing. And vulnerability for an eight, I think it's real easy for us to point out our flaws and to make you feel like I'm being vulnerable, or at least for me. Like it's easy for me to be like, oh, here's all the things that happened to me. Like, isn't that me being vulnerable? But there's a difference when you like really let down those guards around your heart, and that intimacy is—it's real scary to touch. But when it starts getting touched, it really, really changes you. You know. And I love that.
I love it. So. Can we thank Benjamin for sharing? Thanks, brother. I'm out.
Take your stuff. I freaking love this stuff. I could do it all day, every day. Oh, it's the best. It's the best. I love people. I love humanity. And I love all the intricacies of our humanity. So this stuff is just so good. And I love about this series and the Enneagram that it is allowing us to actually do the thing that we're always saying we value. Like, we value seeing into the heart and soul of who someone is so that we can understand them and not just judge them. And oh my God, the Enneagram is so doing that for us. I think I definitely have always judged eights, and now I won't judge them. Now I know them. I know them. They also super trigger me because they're like a mirror for me, because I have a lot of eight, and I'm not an eight, but I like Colby said. And so for me, it's like, I don't like that you're acting like that, but it's because I know that I act like that sometimes. So that's fun too, huh? All that personal introspection. So I get to talk about the 9's today, and I love 9's. I am like so in love with 9's. Like just the whole section of humanity that is 9, I'm in love with them. I just think they are the coolest, best people ever. But I did used to completely misunderstand them as well, though. And they used to, they didn't trigger me, but they used to drive me insane. I love you. But they used to just drive me insane. But now I just think I like worship them. They're the coolest people. And I got so geeked out over who the 9's are and what they can do. They are incredible, incredible human beings. So I'm excited to tell you about that. So 9's are our agreeable, reassuring, and extremely understanding folk. 9's need peace. And that may seem like, well, duh, we all do. But again, just like Colby said, with 8's needing control or to not be controlled, we all have that experience. But for 9's, the need for peace is just this strong, strong force and drive behind everything they do. And we got to understand what a 9 means when they say peace. Peace, specifically for a 9, means the absence of conflict. So we're going to come back around to that in just a second. But no other type is more devoted to the quest for internal and external peace for themselves and others. They are called the peacemakers. The peacemakers. A 9 needs to know that you and I get along with each other, and mostly that we get along with them. They will feel okay as long as everybody else feels okay. Okay, and this comes from a childhood of, in some way or another, obviously it's different for every 9, but in some way or another, a 9 did not feel seen. Often they're referred to as the lost child. It's very common for them to be a middle child or in a family with a lot of kids. They felt lost in the mix somehow. Maybe that looked like lost in the mix because there was a lot of drama going on, a lot of conflict, especially with a parent, that made them feel lost. But whatever it was that was going on, the message was sent to a 9. They heard. Whether they heard it explicitly, actually, literally said to them, or if they just perceived it, either way, the message they heard was, it's not okay to assert yourself. It's not okay to assert yourself. The greatest fear for a nine. I'm like flying through this because I'm recognizing how late it's getting. I love our nines. I want to take so much time on them. The greatest fear for a nine is disconnection, loss, and separation. Okay? That fear drives them. One of the terms that I love from the Enneagram is the lost childhood message. So we all receive messages. We hear things spoken to us, again, whether explicitly or implicitly, we hear these messages. But then there's things that we didn't hear. And I really love exploring that with the Enneagram. And the thing that a nine didn't hear was your presence and your opinions matter. Your presence and your opinions matter. In childhood, they developed this sense of, I need to not rock the boat. I need to not make waves. And my very basic assertions, like preferences, to them, that is the equivalent of rocking the boat or making waves. Just saying, I prefer to do this rather than this, that to a nine is rocking the boat. That is making waves. And so they will avoid conflict at literally all cost. A nine believes that they'll be okay as long as you and I are okay, as long as everyone else is okay, as long as everyone around them is okay. So this makes them self-forgetting and self-neglecting. The nines are the people who they, when you say, where do you want to go to dinner tonight? They go, I don't care, wherever you want to go. Where everybody else wants to go. They're the I don't care, it doesn't matter people. More than any other number on the Enneagram, they avoid conflict. They are the conflict aversion peeps. Again, like I said, nines view peace. That's their need. Their need is for peace. But they view peace in a very specific way, which is the absence of conflict. The quest for this peace, for a nine, translates to actually not just the need for peace, but it's really the need to avoid. The need to avoid. And this need to avoid, and again, as Colby talked about, there's healthy and unhealthy and a whole spectrum. So a very unhealthy nine will need this peace, this absence of conflict so much that it becomes a need to avoid, and avoid to the extent of not experiencing life. They will literally just not feel anything about life. That's how strong their need to have an absence of conflict is. And not just have an absence of conflict, but their idea of what conflict is, and you're beginning to see how 8's and 9's are complete opposites, right? So an 8 will feel very comfortable in conflict, like we're connecting, whereas a 9 feels like any conflict at all means they've lost all connection. Okay, they have experienced that deep fear that they're so afraid of. Just you and I simply disagreeing about something, even if it's where to go for dinner, even if you just say, I want pizza tonight, and they don't, that to them will feel like a conflict that will bring separation between us on a deep relational level. So let's talk about the strengths of the nine real quick. I love nines. Okay, so the nines are also called, along with being called the peacemaker, they are also called the mediator. The mediator. They have this insane ability to bring people together. And here's why. And this is what I just freak out about the nines. It's so cool. And I've always misunderstood this about a nine. A nine literally can see every person's point of view and agree with it. And so if you're in a room with a bunch of people, like the 8 can be in an empty house and start a fight, a 9 can be in a house jam-packed full of people, and each person in that house has a different point of view that contradicts the person next to them, like opposite points of view. And you'll watch the 9 turn to each person and go, uh-huh, totally, I agree with you. Uh-huh, totally, I agree with you. Uh-huh, totally, yep, I agree with you. And so me, the way I always misunderstood nines, is I thought that that was a show. I thought that was something they did. I understood they were trying to gain peace, but I thought they that was kind of like a manipulation, like a way to try to get that peace. But what I found out is actually very, very true about the nines is that they actually really, truly do agree with each person. It's not fake at all. It's not a manipulation. It's not a projection. It is absolutely 100% true, because what we found to be true about nines is that they are the least corrupted by dualistic thinking people out there. Okay? So they don't see life through a dualistic lens. Again, the opposites of eights. It's not black and white thinking. Everything to a nine is gray area. Everything. Nuance, absolutely. Paradox, oh my gosh, they love it. They can live in it. They are our spiritual leaders because they can live in a place of this is true and 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 also that's true and that's true and that's true and that's true. It's all true to them. It's all true and it's real. They actually can see your perspective. So there's this story in A Road Back to You, which is the book that a lot of you are following along with for your small groups. And there's this story about the nines. Suzanne, who co-wrote the book, Ian tells the story for her, actually, but she co-wrote the book, and it's the story about how her husband, who's a nine, is a Methodist pastor, and he does couples counseling. And in their church, this woman will, like, snuggle up next to Suzanne, and she'll say, I'm so glad your husband is doing marriage counseling for us because he gets how it really is. He sees the truth of what's going on between my husband and I. Like, he gets me. He knows that I'm the one that's right. Like, he gets my point of view, right? She's like, okay, cool, yeah, so glad my husband's doing that for you. 5 minutes later, the husband of that wife snuggles up next to her and says the same exact thing. I'm so glad your husband is counseling us because he gets me, he gets my point of view is the way that things are actually happening in the relationship. That's a nine's way of really, actually, and it's true. They really do get both of the perspectives in the marriage. They really do see how this person's truth is really truth, and this person's truth is really truth, and they can hold it all together in the same space. It's amazing. Contradictions don't feel like contradictions to nines. They may feel conflict really strong, and that's too tense for them, but tension as in ideas and beliefs and differing opinions, they don't feel that as tension. That's not tension to them. You and I sitting and having a disagreement, they don't see the ideas as tension. You and I having conflict, they're like, no! But that comes from that place of they see that we're not really disagreeing. They don't think we really are. Because they see how everybody's truth can sit there. It blows my mind, because I'm so not like that. I would relate to the eight more, where I'm like, no, it's this way. But nines are like, it's all the ways. It's amazing. Our sons, Colby and I, is a nine, a total nine. And it's really cool, because we actually gave him a name that means peacemaker, and then the nine is a peacemaker. And I didn't tell you this yet, but we were driving to church this morning, and I was telling them about that cool fact about his name, and Zeke pipes in and goes, yeah, but maybe that's just because you guys made him a peacemaker. Philosophical discussion, nature versus nurture, who knows? But either way, it's cool, and he's total nine. And what happens in our house is there'll be a disagreement between my nine son, my peacemaker son, and one of the other kids. And I'll come in and see that, like, it's an unjust situation happening. Like, my sweet peacemaker son, Ty, is, like, getting hurt in this situation, right? It's unfair to him. So I'll come in and try to mediate, but the true mediator, Ty. So I'll come in and I'll stand up for Ty, and I'll be like, the other one, you know, and I'll point out the other one is, like, wrong. Ty jumps in, stands up for the kid that I just stood up to him again. What? I just like, honey, I was trying to stand up for you. And he's like, but I see why Zeke is right. What? It's amazing. We need nines in disagreement. A healthy nine can help us get along and build bridges. Nines can make great counselors and therapists and spiritual leaders. They are the most empathetic of all the numbers on the Enneagram, which I think you would understand after I just described how much they truly get what each person is saying. They really do feel you when you describe your situation to them. They get it. They're super inclusive, which again comes from that getting everybody. They really do truly understand each and every individual. So for the nines in your life, for being in a relationship with a nine will have the tendency to disappear or merge with the people they're with. So a nine has a very strong tendency to just disappear into the person that they have a relationship with. And so if you're in a relationship with a nine, it's very important to dial back your dominant personality a little bit. Not to the point where you're not you, but to recognize I am with a nine, and that carries a lot of responsibility because they'll just disappear into my life. One of the great pieces of advice that I read this week about being with a nine is to give them three options for things, like the dinner thing, going out to dinner. Give them three options and let them pick one. And then when they pick one, do that one. Because remember, a nine's message is that their preference doesn't matter and that might actually cause conflict or separation. So they need you to reinforce the truth that actually their preference does matter and it's not going to cause separation and it's okay. I can go to pizza with you even though I didn't want to go to pizza with you and we're okay. We have to like prove that to our nines and show them that that's okay and help them in that. Keep in mind that, like I said, that they really do agree with everyone. Okay, that's not fake. So if you get frustrated because your partner's a nine and they're agreeing with the person that you disagree with, but they're also agreeing with you, and you're like, just take my side, damn it. Just keep in mind that like they really actually do. They're not like being fake about that. That's a genuine thing for them. They really do just see both sides of it really well. Raising, another really good thing to keep in mind in relationship with nines is that raising your voice in the slightest sounds like yelling to a nine. Conflict feels so much bigger. I think I mentioned this a little bit to a nine. We may think we're just having a tiny disagreement, but they think the world is crashing down on top of them. While an eight can see conflict as a way to connect, again, a nine will feel like that's a way to disconnect, to experience loss and separation. So the good news for a nine is that your voice and presence really do matter. Your voice and presence really do matter. The journey for a nine is to find their own voice. I want to say to you today, sweet, sweet nines, you were not invited to earth by God so that someone else could live your life. I don't know why that's making me so emotional, but it is, so let's just sit in that. I just think our world is not whole if some of the people on it are disappearing. And nines have so much to offer us. I want to hear them actually have their voice. Nines, we need to hear you in order to love you. We need to hear you in order to love you. If you just disappear and merge into who we are, we can't love you. Okay, the invitation for a nine this morning. This is so cool, and I hope I can communicate it okay, because it's kind of tricky. But so Ian Cron, who co-wrote that book, A Road Back to You, he says that the Enneagram shows us that our blights and our blessings are all confused. It's just another way of saying that our weaknesses and our strengths are actually the same thing. And it's just a matter of taking it and flipping it the other way so that it becomes the strength. So it's like when we say things about how an unhealthy nine can act like this and a healthy nine can act like this, what we're saying is flip that weakness and use it as your strength. So for a nine, their weakness would be that they have this absolutely compulsive need to have what they call peace, what we often call peace, but their definition of that is a lack of conflict. And so that would be the weakness part, because what they end up doing is just avoiding conflict, avoiding life. But what's so freaking cool about nines is that they have all those incredible strengths that we just talked about. If they are able to walk into that weakness, that's not really a weakness. If they can have just as much of a strong driving force inside of them for peace, but not understand that peace to be an absence of conflict, if they can instead flip that idea in their head and still seek peace just as hard as they work at it when they're working at it to be an avoidance of conflict. If they can work just as hard at peace and see peace as something else, then they will absolutely flip this planet upside down, change everything, because they have the most empathetic tools of any number. So it's often said of a nine that the only number that they don't relate to is their own number. They relate to 1 through 8. And that's that empathy piece. That's that agreeing with everybody. And so if a nine is able to step into conflict and just tell themselves, even though they won't feel it, okay, I'm just going to trust that I'm stepping into this conflict, and to me this feels like the opposite of my deep, 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 at my core desire to have peace. I'm just going to do it anyway and trust that if I step into this conflict and practice being okay anyway and practice all my strengths, all my tools of empathy, then that actually is what will make peace. I'll actually step into my true name of the peacemaker and the mediator. But if I, as a nine, am avoiding conflict, I can't actually live into my name of peacemaker. I can't actually live into my name of mediator, because I'm not even anywhere near the conflict. I can't make peace out of nothing, out of avoiding. Eckhart Tolle says that the moment you completely accept your non-peace, the moment that you completely accept your non-peace, it transmutes into peace. Anything that you accept fully will get you there. It will take you into peace. That's the miracle of surrender. Our nines have to learn how to practice surrender to the non-peace in order to truly get that thing that they're searching for. And what's so cool about nines is that they're so comfortable with paradox that they actually have the exact tool they need. They can see the paradox in all the peace, non-peace stuff. They can actually be comfortable with that and get that idea if they can just get themselves to get there. They have the tools they need to walk into the non-peace and learn that therein is that peace that they're searching so desperately for. Does that make sense? Our nines today need to hear this quote by Dorothy Thompson, which says, "Peace is not the absence of conflict, but the presence of creative alternatives for responding to conflict. Alternatives to passive or aggressive responses, alternatives to violence." Our nines have those creative alternatives built right into their personality. All that empathy, all that ability to see nuance and paradox, and to see conflicting ideas as not so much conflicting, it's just different, and to be able to sit in that. They have those creative tools. They just need to step into it. Does that make sense, how we work against ourselves? Like the very thing that nines are seeking so desperately, peace. Like they have all the tools to make it, but that desperate need for peace actually causes them to not get the peace because they just avoid. And so if they can stop avoiding, they can get the very thing that they're desperately searching for. Follow? All right. I flew through that. Let's bring Rachel Joy up because she is a nine. Hi, Rachel.
Hi.
I adore you. Nines are so cool. Oh, this morning before church, I told her that I was nervous to share about nines because what if I screwed up? And she goes, "Whatever you say, I'll agree with." Okay, so tell us a little bit about your process for figuring out your number. What was that like for you?
Yeah. So I got into Enneagram probably about 4 years ago. And for me, I was really excited to read about the nine, and hey, I am a nine. It wasn't really that scary for me. I think it wasn't because I necessarily wanted to be a nine. I mean, I like being a nine, but I think for me, I was really familiar with these kinds of tests. I took a ton of them in college. It was just, you know, it's a pretty regular thing for me. But every time I read the results, it was kind of like, meh, I mean, sure, yeah, I think I kind of relate to that, but just maybe not fully. And I had then kind of gone through the process of coming out, which, you know, kind of causes you to do a little bit of self-reflection, I think. The Enneagram, I think, was the first test I took on the other side of that. And
on the other side of coming out?
Of coming out, yeah. Okay. So I think it was probably the first time I answered questions on the test or really looked at everything really honestly, because I, you know, I would kind of, I think before, allow people to kind of, their perceptions of me to dictate how I answered. And so then I wouldn't really fully, you know, identify with the results. And so that was, you know, kind of taking the Enneagram honestly and then seeing the results. It was like, 9 wing 1, done. That is me. Like, I got it. And then I could kind of take those tools and move forward. So for me, it was like a confirmation that, okay, yeah, I actually am
this
starting
is
to
who
know
I
myself.
Am.
Yeah.
That's awesome. I love it. Okay, so what do you really like about being a 9?
I think maybe everybody says this about their numbers. I think 9s are the best of the numbers. We're the best.
I kind of do, too, after reading about 9s this week.
I think, I mean, I think, like, any group or any family, I think, or team, whatever it is, I think you need a 9 in your life because I have seen in my life, I really do, I identify with what people say. I don't have to necessarily, you know, that doesn't have to be my background of where I came from or I don't have to fully understand it. I can find in it what I agree with. Yeah. And I think that that's a really cool tool to use. And I think what's super cool that I have seen kind of in looking at the Enneagram is when 9s, or at least for me, I know, like, when I feel supported and healthy, I move to a place of a 3. And, like, that is such a cool thing that, you know, a goal-oriented peacemaker. Like, I don't know what could be better than that. So that's, I see that in myself a lot, I think, especially when I'm feeling healthy. I like to take the information I get or kind of little tidbits I can get from people, different ideas, and put them all together to come up with a way to peacefully move forward.
Meaning you stop disappearing and you start, like, here I am and fully doing your thing. That's so cool. So what has gotten in your way about being a 9?
I think probably the kind of the big one, which is kind of a maybe obvious for a lot of 3s, of course, is conflict avoidance. I am super uncomfortable with conflict of any sort. I don't even have to be in the conflict. Like, I can see 2 other people, like, in conflict. I'm like, oh, that gives me anxiety. I hate it. So, you know, and so I think that, you know, totally avoiding conflict definitely, you know, kind of like I said, led me to a place of not being very self-aware. I can be a people pleaser for sure, you know, because I see that as a way of being like, everybody be happy, you know, like, I just want people to be happy. But by being a people pleaser, I don't listen to what I want. I don't even want to admit that I, like, want or need something. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's definitely been a challenge for me, and something that I kind of have realized, like, there's kind of two kinds of conflict. I have internal conflicts, and I have to admit that. And then once I'm able to deal with my internal conflicts and kind of face those, it gives me better tools to work with external conflicts, too, even if I'm really uncomfortable with it.
I love that, the internal to the external. I really believe in that way of approaching life. That's so cool. Thank you so much for sharing, Rachel. Yay. Freaking love 9s. I love 8s, too. 8s are cool, but I was doing the 9. You want to come up and do communion together? All right. We went really late today. This stuff is a lot, but thank you for sitting tight with us.
We won't go this late every time. Promise.
Yeah, promise.
We're just
trying to tighten it up. We're figuring it out.
We'll just cut the music out. What? I'm just kidding. I'm kidding.
No. Hopefully, even if you're not an 8 or a 9, you're able to see pieces of yourself in all of this and definitely learn how to better relate to those in your life who are the 8s and 9s.